I'm Brook Lee, and this is Modern Wahine Hawaii. Welcome to Modern Wahine Hawaii here at the Hawaii Convention Center. I'm with Mehana Hind from CNHA. First of all, let's start at the beginning. Let's tell everybody what CNHA is for those who live under a rock.
Sure. The Council for Native Hawaiian Advancement is a little over 20 years right now. It started in 2001. Small nonprofit, I always say this, a small, feisty.
I mean, we're talking small. Yeah. We're talking folding tables and kapolei.
Right.
You know,
small, feisty bunch, you know, of people out in kapolei. We've always been feisty.
Right. And so now you guys are like the go-to people for all things that you need help in the Hawaiian community and around. And you kind of need to fix something or you need to find some answers, this is where you go.
We've always operated under inspired leadership.
Right.
So when there's a need that's identified, we go.
Right.
Yeah.
So for now, because obviously we're going to talk about Maui because so much to go for there, the kuleana over there. And from the get-go, you guys were really just sort of stepping in and being like, okay, so what is needed? And how can we kokua? And not just materialistically as well, because that's important too, but also all the other aspects.
And you know, the community has faced unimaginable devastation.
Can't even
remember. And the resiliency shown within the community themselves is remarkable.
Astounding.
People don't know what to make of it. They're just like, we just set up Kanaka Costco's all over Lahaina and Apili, and we don't want to, at CNHA, we don't want to overshadow what's going on already in the community.
Organically in the community.
But we know that when we talk to the leadership, you know, in the community in Maui, you know, they identified certain needs and we say, okay, we can do that part. The first thing we did immediately was, you know, talk to the people on the ground, you know, and I think our CEO was on the ground within a few days, just having conversations to assess the needs. We launched a giving campaign, a matching campaign that up, you know, to the end of August, you know, was up to almost $7 million in the matching campaign. We also partnered with a bunch of initiatives that were also doing fundraising too. Maui Ola, one of them, you know, Mana Ola did a show, and we were working in collaboration to help be a bridge between the people who wanted to do things and receiving funds and being able to get it out to the community. We also just at the beginning of September launched the Resource Hub. So we hired people from Lahaina to come and operate our resource hub.
And it's a hale, it's a brick and mortar.
Yeah. It's at Maui Mall and it'll be there, you know, for as long as the need is is there to be able to help people process all those very tedious applications, get the services that they need. There's mental health services, you know, that are in there and access to that, financial information and so forth. And then we also mid-September launched a trades program because we realize there's people who are out of work because businesses are down. There is a cleanup that will need to happen and a rebuilding that will need to happen. We got
to
get our people in line
to be able to help.
Certified to be able to do hazmat removal, you know, all the basic OSHA trainings. So we're launching that program too out of there. And then on the cultural end, we participated on September 1st with a statewide vigil. You know, with community and interfaith. It was interfaith. It was a huge effort to do that, but everybody wanted to show their aloha. And on October 1st, we are gathering, you know, kumu hula from Maui. We're gonna bring them to Oahu. We're gonna have a hula workshop that day. They're gonna come and teach Maui mele. You know, so we as hula people can come together as a community, learn mele specifically, and ho'omana that ola of that place.
That's amazing. See, those are the things that I think are being finally being addressed, that, you know, in the immediate trauma of everything, you know, you're going about shelter and food and safety, all of that stuff is important.
Yes.
But also from a cultural standpoint, there's this whole other part of the being that needs to be addressed fairly quickly. What's residing in me and around me and how I am healing myself is a little different than they do it on the mainland.
It is,
yeah.
It is.
You can't explain it. It's literally in the na'au. So.
And that's the volunteers who are coming from all across the US, you know, they're just like, we've never seen this before. Yeah. What are you guys doing? And I said, that's aloha.
Yeah, that's how
it works. That's aloha right there, and that's ohana.
Yeah.
Right? And talking about donation, I totally forgot. We set up a warehouse here on Oahu, along with the Lieutenant Governor and the Office of Hawaiian Affairs. We set up a donation site. So now all the donations are centralized in Kaka'ako. Mm-hmm. And then when Maui calls and says, hey, we need this, this, and this, we're able to, with organization and management, send over what is needed on Maui. And then now we're also helping with the Maui end of that receiving warehouse on that end. And that's been a huge operation of intaking goods and being able to share it with the community. And we wasn't warehouse managers before.
But you're in now.
We are now. Yeah, we're helping, we're connecting on the ground nonprofits to be able to run those sites, so it's increasing their capacity.
Yeah.
And it's also providing a much needed, at this point in the recovery, service to the community.
I mean, I don't know when you get time to rest or have a snack, but thank you so much for all of your guys' kuleana and all the work you do. I mean, we see it. We do. We see you guys out there, and we know that you guys are getting air purifiers. You guys are getting people what they need when they need it, in the moment that they need it. And we just mahalo all of you guys, because we know that, you know, we all want to do what we can, but we can only do so much. And then when we see other people and the pilina with everybody with their hands, it's like, it makes everybody feel better that we got this, we're going to get through this.
I have absolute faith that we are able and ready to take care of ourselves here in Hawaii.
Yeah.
We have the talent, we have the expertise to be able to navigate these waters. We have allies and friends, you know, from around the world that, you know, we're willing to work with. So that's been key. And again, we are just one drop in comparison to the on the ground work that is happening within the community and all those levels. Economic revitalization, spiritual counsel, you know, that the communities themselves are offering each other. And that to me is where like the hope and the
That's why it's Maui Nakoi. I mean, Maui Nakoi is Maui Nakoi for a reason.
I'm gonna say this one more time. I hardly ever say this because I'm from Oahu, but Maui Nakoi.
Maui is Nakoi.
Mahalo.
For sure. Yeah. Thanks for coming on the show.
Mahalo, mahalo.
Don't go anywhere, we'll be right back. Welcome back to Modern Wahine Hawaii here at the Hawaii Convention Center. I am with Michelle Kaʻuhane, who has been very busy with Hawaii Community Foundation. How are you?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
It's been a busy season of kuleana here in the community with the lahui, and there's been a lot going on. Why don't you kind of give everybody a little bit of background about Hawaii Community Foundation?
The Community Foundation is a 106-year-old trusted organization. We really bring together the generosity of donors and connect that to the nonprofit sector that's on the ground serving community. I think our visibility and what we do really comes to the forefront during a time of emergency because of that 106-year-old trusted entity that it is a safe place to put dollars that need to be deployed quickly. And so during this Maui wildfire and prior to this COVID, we really got a lot of visibility in our ability to work with donors, work with the community on the ground to get dollars out where they're needed pretty quickly.
And so with the Maui Strong Fund, HCF didn't create this fund specifically after the wildfires happened. There's a strong fund for every single island. If you go to the website, every single island is listed.
Correct.
It just so happened that this horrible, horrific thing happened on the island of Maui. And so Maui Strong Fund was there.
Yes.
Living in its bubble.
So you're absolutely correct. A few years back, we went through the eruptions, the volcanic eruptions in Kilauea, and at the same time we were seeing flooding on Kauai, and from that we learned a lot. Mm. And so the funds exist always, and we put a little bit in from our operating budget, from our grant making budget each year, so that if and when a disaster happens that we're able to respond quickly. So the Maui Strong Fund was actually created back in the beginning, early 2019, mm. prior to COVID, mm-hmm. and we activated quickly when the pandemic hit,
right.
and on August 9th, we activated again for response to the Maui wildfires.
And so let's talk about response, because I mean, the response was, I mean, astronomical, right?
The response to the Maui Strong Fund has been, I don't even know how to put words. It is unprecedented, absolutely. We have seen support for the Maui Strong Fund fund from across the globe. We had a couple of platforms where we take donations mm-hmm. in. In the last 4 weeks, we have had to expand to have 7 additional platforms so wow. that we can convert yen and we can Wait. Convert other forms of capital coming from across the globe. The outpouring of aloha for the families and for the community has been just amazing.
Right.
And so we're very grateful. Everyone is working hard, working long hours, and trying to get all of those dollars out into the community as quickly as possible.
Right.
I think key to the Maui Strong Fund and how we operate is a four-phase strategy that we are grounded in, that we follow. Mm-hmm. We talk about rapid response, then recovery and stabilization, mm-hmm. and back to resilience. This was a no-warning
right.
Disaster, and so we had to act quickly. Within the first 4 hours, we had a press conference and reached out to some of our solid donors that are with us throughout the year, mm-hmm. And we're able to raise the first $1 million, and from there, it's just escalated. As of the end of August, we are at about $86 million,
wow.
and we've put nearly $14 million in grants out the door to communities who are on the ground, on the front line.
Wow. It takes a lot. There's such a faceted issues going on, and like everybody wants to help, and you try to find best persons for best seats, right? But at the core of it really is the Maui people, because Maui really sort of rallied themselves like no one had ever. If you know Maui people, you weren't surprised.
No.
But for the rest of the world to see how fast the galvanization happened, it was really kind of profound for a lot of people. And then when you guys come into the community, there's that extra layer of understanding and cultural sort of interaction, because you guys know how to approach it from a standpoint of, you know, this is what the culture needs.
Absolutely. I think our role is really that of a convener, and we each have a role to play. I think CNHA is really good about understanding the needs of our Native Hawaiian community, and we have other nonprofits who deal with our COFA migrants and the Filipino mm-hmm. population in that area. The Community Foundation's role is really, we have a strong understanding of all of the different nonprofits and community and who's doing what. Our role is really to facilitate the giving, to get
right.
donors, to bring dollars to the state, and to answer the demand and the call of the people of Maui who want to be a part of the solution building.
Right.
And so our role really is to bring all of those things together, the resources from generous donors, understanding the community voices on the ground, the nonprofits, and then the government, that we have to get through this with, it's gonna take government support.
Right.
And there's a lot of mistrust and
yeah.
and conversation about who wants to or doesn't want to
right.
deal with government, but we all have a role to play, and so our role really is that, to bring people to the table, to be a convener, and to make sure that the resources are reaching the communities, not just for today, but for the long haul.
Yeah.
So this recovery is a marathon,
not a sprint.
We know that in disaster response, about 80% of the dollars get raised early on
right.
in the first few
and
months.
And then it sort of trickles off.
But 80% of the work is gonna happen
yeah,
in the next 3 to 5 years.
Right.
And so just being conscious and aware that we need to be here for Maui for mm-hmm. the long haul. And so continuing to raise dollars, to be careful about how we're putting those dollars out, and really leaning into trusted relationships with nonprofits who are doing the work all year round.
I mean, I think that's key for people to understand, is the trusted part of it, because after 106 years of doing something, we haven't gone anywhere in this amount of time where we've been helping people as long as we have. We can continue to do that.
Absolutely. We'll still be here, and there are things that we're good at, and there are things that our community is better at. Right. And so balancing both, right? Making sure that we're listening to the call of the people, including community voice in the decision making and the grant making, and really being able to provide resource for the long haul. There's a lot that the government can do, and then there's a lot
they
They can't. Yeah. And so how do we backfill and use philanthropy where government can't play a role?
I feel so much better now, Michelle, knowing that you guys are at the helm. And we're going to be in it until every coconut tree on Pu'umana is upright and standing with coconuts on it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's going to happen. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Appreciate you.
Mahalo.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Modern Wahine Hawaii here at the Hawaii Convention Center. I am here with Mālie Lyman. How are you?
I'm good.
You've been busy. I've been watching you on socials. You've been breaking hearts and taking names. I can't even tell you, after Lahaina happened, when you hopped up on socials and sang Lahaina Luna, like, people were on their knees. So thank you for coming on the show, because I wanted to talk about your latest social media posts. You guys are working on these outreaches about Maui music through Mana Maoli. Can you tell people about that?
So when I made that Lahaina Luna music video, I've been thinking about doing it for like a few days before it happened. And when I did it, I wasn't expecting it to get that much attention.
Right.
But it was in a way that kind of proves that music can help unite people, and music definitely does heal, especially in times of need. And that's what motivated the hashtag Mele for Maui that's happening right now. And we've received so many videos of people singing songs dedicated to Maui, songs that people wrote for Maui. And it's just a different feeling seeing everybody come together through music, because music is like a universal language. It's one thing that everyone can agree on and everyone can understand and love, like, no matter what genre you listen to.
Or language you speak, or God you believe in.
Exactly.
For sure. And, you know, your grandmama, Auntie Janoa Kiawe, was a huge ambassador of aloha and of Hawaiian music, and traveled the world, really, spreading that aloha spirit. And to see you sort of step into an awful situation, but to see you guys out there in the community and just sitting there on the beach with your ukuleles and your guitars, just singing with people, because really, for us, it's kind of where you go. Like, it's your safe place to go to. Like, when you have nothing else, let's all just sing Kanaka Vai Vai, or let's, like, you know, sing Hawaii Aloha, or get on the same page. And this is how we do it culturally. This is how we reset. So the kahea is, people can hashtag for music Mele for Maui, and send in their songs and their mana'o and just their love, and people can see it and share it through social media. How's it been with the outreach?
It's cool to see. Like, you don't realize how many people are watching and, like, paying attention until, like, things like this happen.
Right.
And I've seen videos of people from New Zealand, people from all over the nation. There was this one video of people, I think it was Samoa, and they, like hundreds of people got together and all were dancing and singing a song for Maui.
Wow.
It's something really cool, and I, like, love that everyone's just, like, coming together with that.
Yeah, I mean, it helps heal some of the hurt, I think, for people, because there's just so much to have to process.
Yeah, and it, like, takes your mind off of, like, everything bad that's going on.
Right, and takes you to a better place, for sure. Do you have a song that you could probably share with us that might take all of us to a better place after all of this? Like, what's the go-to for you these days?
I do. It's not Lahaina Luna's alma mater, but when I went to Maui as a field trip in fifth or sixth grade, my teacher was from Maui, so she taught us this song. And the one time that I sang this song on Maui was when I went to go visit the families. And we actually just sang it at the airport. But the flight attendants working at the customer service, they said that they love the music, and she turned and said, oh, this is da-da-da. She also lost her home in the fire, but she really appreciates your guys' music, and she loves that you guys are doing this. I actually started crying because I saw her start, like, crying, and it was a really touching moment because, and then she came up to us after and said that she graduated from Lahaina Luna, so that song means a lot to her.
Nice. Okay, well, let's fire her up. Let's hear this beautiful song that you have. Well, that's our show for today, Hawaii. I hope you learned as much as I did from all of these wonderful women, whether it be Mehana over at CNHA or Michelle with HCF, all of the wonderful work that they are doing. Mālie Lyman with her beautiful voice and all of the manao she's shared with us with going to Maui and with Mana Maoli and their programs to help heal through music. If you can donate, I know Hawaii, you guys have come up strong. Please feel free to donate again and send your aloha to Maui. As I do, we're in this for the long haul. Like Michelle said, this is going to be a marathon, so we're going to be in it till Lahaina is strong again. Mahalo for watching, and we'll see all of you next week.